part cooling fan is something which has become a necessity on all 3D printers since the days we started printing parts in PLA or similar materials. But does this cool stream of air that helps us print very detailed models maybe reduce the strength of our parts? This is exactly what I've tested in today's video, and we'll also learn how different fan settings change the accuracy of our 3D printed parts using a 3D scanner. Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. This video is sponsored by Audible. When the first RepRap printers emerged in the home of makers, the material of choice was usually ABS, where cooling the printed material down too quickly will cause layer separation and is therefore not really wanted. Only after materials like PLA have been becoming more and more popular, fans that rapidly cool down the printed material were needed to print fine details and overhangs. In contrast to ABS, PLA also doesn't have the tendency to crack between the layers or to separate from the build platform when being cooled. Nowadays, people seem to even challenge themselves to get the most amount of cooling for their printers. This has raised the question for me if too much cooling could actually be detrimental for the strength of all 3D printed parts, because it reduces the temperature of the previous layer and gives the new material less time to bond together. If you have ever watched one of my filament test videos, you might know that I usually print two of 3D Maker Noob's temperature towers, where on one I vary the part cooling in steps and then choose the one with the lowest amount of cooling but still good print quality. This is because I always assumed that less cooling also means better layer adhesion. Though I never tested this assumption in a controlled manner, so this is what we'll do in today's video. This video is actually one part of a video series where I want to test the influence of different settings on the strength of our 3D prints, with the goal of finding a combination of parameters for maximizing the toughness of our parts. If you don't want to miss that, then make sure to subscribe to the channel and ring the bell to be notified of upcoming videos. Due to popular demand, I won't be focusing today's tests solely on PLA, but also include PETG. Unfortunately, this material cost me quite some troubles, as you'll see later, and I actually had to redo all of the tests with a second filament brand. This is also where today's sponsor Audible comes in, because they don't only entertain and educate me during travel and work, their support also enables me to invest more time in investigations like these. You guys probably all know Audible by now. Audible has the biggest selection of audiobooks on the planet, and it got even bigger with their new Audible Originals, which is content that was especially created for your listening experience and which you can find anywhere else. I really need to tell you about an audiobook I recently listened to while on a business trip, to which you can also listen for free with a 30-day trial by visiting audible.com/cnckitchen or texting cnckitchen, all one word, to 500-500. The book is called Skunk Works by Ben Rich, in which he talks about his years at Lockheed and the development of the stealth airplanes like the F-117 and the SR-71 Blackbird. As an engineer myself, I was so drawn into his stories on all of the technical challenges they had to overcome. He even tells interesting stories about tiny details like the titanium airframe of the SR-71 becoming brittle because their tap water was chlorinated during a couple of hot weeks in the Californian summer. Or about the political situation during the Cold War and how they were still able to basically source all of the titanium used in the SR-71 from the Soviet Union without them noticing. I seriously couldn't stop listening, and if you're also just the slightest bit passionate about aeronautics and engineering, definitely listen to this audiobook. Visit audible.com/cnckitchen or text cnckitchen to 500-500 to get this or any other audiobook and additionally two Audible originals for free. No risk involved, and you can even keep all of your audiobooks forever if you at some point decide to cancel the service. Thank you Audible for sponsoring this episode. I usually test the strength of 3D printed materials with these dog bone tensile test specimens that I print at 100% infill in horizontal and vertical printing orientation. The horizontal specimens tell us how strong the base polymer is because we load it in the printing direction where you don't have layer lines, reducing the strength. The vertical specimens, on the other hand, test exactly the opposite, and this is how good subsequent printed layers stick together. Ideally, the strength would be similar, but the strength of standing specimens is usually at least 50% lower. Unfortunately, these specimens gave me quite some trouble in the past, because if the two jaws of my test machine don't align perfectly, the coupons will see a slight bending load instead of pure tension, and therefore fail prematurely and invalidate the results. For this reason, I designed a new set of samples that feature half spheres on both ends, which are still nicely printable. With a suitable sleeve and a holder, they form a spherical bearing and minimize the bending loads of the sample. This greatly reduced the scatter in my results and will be the new shape I'll use for layer adhesion tests. For this series of tests, I've printed 3 samples for 5 different fan settings, which makes 15 samples in total for each of the materials. The fan settings I used were 0%, 20%, 40%, 60%, and 100%. I printed all of the samples in a single print job, where each group of samples was finished one after another. In order to compare the strength values at different fan settings to a baseline, I also printed 3 horizontal dog bones, but these ones only at one single fan speed, since I boldly state that there won't be a significant change regardless of the cooling. Please bear in mind that these set of results are probably not 100% true for any other filament manufacturer and printer, because slight changes in the setup can have a huge impact on the results. So use this more as a guideline and look at the trends. I printed all of the samples on my original Prusa i3 Mark 2.5 at a layer height of 0.15 mm with 2 perimeters and 100% infill. At the time of printing, it was summer and I had between 26 and 27 degrees centigrade in my office. I printed the samples in Spoolworks PLA, DAS filament PETG, and Printament PETG from a Printer Pro. In general, the prints looked nice. You were only able to see that the prints with no cooling did show some problems in the overhanging regions. Let's start with the test results of the PLA parts that I tested one after another on my self-built universal test machine. The baseline that I printed lying, which should represent the ideal and maximum material strength, failed at 59 MPa with only very little scatter. Next we come to the layer adhesion samples, where the ones with 100% fan speed failed at 30 MPa, so only half what the horizontal coupons were able to bear. At 60% and 40% fan, the results were only slightly better with 31 and 33 MPa of tensile strength. At only 20% cooling fan, we can already see that the layer adhesion already improves, and the specimens failed on average at 38 MPa, which is already 64% of our baseline. Lastly, we have the samples that were printed with no cooling fan at all, and those were able to bear an astounding 48 MPa, which is over 80% of the reference. This shows that we can increase the layer adhesion by more than 50% by decreasing the amount of cooling we use. Next, I tested DAS filament PETG. The tensile strength of the horizontal specimens was 53 MPa with basically no scattering at all. I won't go through the rest of the results though, because they were all over the place and something was extremely wrong with them. There was no pattern recognizable and the strength test results were more or less random. I've been printing a lot with this material over the last years and was usually very happy with it, but here either the material or my printer had quite an issue. As I already said in the beginning, I didn't want to leave my results like this, so I took the time and printed another set of samples in Printament PETG from a Printer Pro. The samples looked really nice and very well extruded because they still kept the kind of translucent look after printing. The baseline tensile strength was slightly lower than the one from DAS filament with 49 MPa. Again, there was basically no scatter between the tests. The layer adhesion strength of the PETG when the fan was 100% on was around 21 MPa, which is only 42% of the baseline and therefore worse than what we have seen with PLA. 60, 40 and 20% were all in the same region with 26 megapascals of ultimate strength, which is an improvement, but still not too well. Only the samples printed with no fan at all were able to bear almost 41 megapascals before they failed, which is only less than 20% lower than our baseline and therefore very impressive. The results kind of confirm what my suspicions were in the past. PETG still seems to be a bit more tricky to print and therefore the results scatter more. Secondly, the material should be printed with less than full cooling fan because this increases strength, but the print quality, as we will see in a minute, still remains nice at settings below 50%. For both PETG and PLA we have seen that the layer adhesion is always significantly lower than the base material strength. Still, we can influence the adhesion with the amount of cooling we use, and less is usually better. In order to check the influence of part cooling on print quality, I have also printed several 3D benches at fan speeds of 0%, 20% and 100%. Ideally, I want to go as low as possible with cooling, but at some point, the prints really start to look horrible. Both PLA and PETG prints without any cooling looked like they were melted in the sun, and I did already increase the layer time to over 20 seconds. That's actually a setting which can help you to print nicer at lower fan settings because it will slow down your prints when a layer takes less than 20 seconds, increasing the natural cooldown time. Chuck from Filament Friday even stated that you can print PLA without any fan at all, but he was using an Endo 3 for his tests. The thing is that all of the CR10 variants have a horrible fan shroud design where the fan that cools the heatsink also directly cools your hot end and the print. So 0% on such a machine is still some cooling and will decrease layer adhesion. The Prusa on the other hand has two totally separate cooling paths where no cooling air from the heatsink touches the print and therefore zero part cooling fan also means no cooling at all. That's also quite important for the higher technical materials like nylon, PC or even ABS. Just keep that in mind. I currently have a professional 3D scanner from the company GOM at my disposal that I can use for a couple of weeks for my research. For this reason, I also scanned all of the 3D benches to find how they really deviate from the ideal geometry. I had to coat the translucent PETG prints with some chalk spray to make them scannable. For the comparison of the scan to the reference geometry, I used GOM Inspect, which can actually be downloaded and used by anyone for free. I will show you a couple of deviation plots in a second. The way you read them is pretty simple. The color is a measurement of the geometrical deviation of the real scanned part to the nominal STL file. Blue is negative, and this means that the real part is smaller or inside the reference. Red means a positive deviation, so the scan is outside of the reference, or basically more material is at that location. Now to the results. I guess for the prints without any cooling fan, we don't really need to talk about deviations because especially the PLA one just looks horrible. The thing that was interesting to see though was that you can clearly see the sagging of the horizontal surfaces on the PETG part. The parts with 20% cooling already looked way better and the PETG one was basically looking perfect, and you almost can't see any quality problems even at this low level of cooling. The PLA Benchy at 20% cooling is even more interesting because it looks okay from one side, but on the other side, which is the side facing away from the part cooling fan, is totally deformed. So it seems as if 20% cooling with the Prusa is still on the low side, and it might be an interesting project to optimize the fan shroud so that it's more even in all directions. If you guys are interested in that topic, there's actually a cool blog post by Nophead, the father of the Mendel 90, on the uniformity of different fan shroud designs. I'll leave a link down below. Both of the 100% prints look perfect on first glance, only the 3D scans revealed there was some deformation in the highly overhanging areas. So nicely printable doesn't always mean geometrically accurate. If you, by the way, have other project ideas I could do with this 3D scanner from GOM, then leave a comment down below. In summary, what have we learned? So I think we have nicely shown that the layer adhesion of FDM parts is significantly influenced by the amount of cooling air that is used. Less cooling usually means better layer strength. Unfortunately, at some point, the looks of all 3D prints is influenced and at low cooling values print quality suffers. PETG is better in this regard than PLA. If you want to improve your part strength, then play around with the amount of cooling and find the lowest possible setting with still sufficient part quality. Slowing down your print and using minimum layer time will help you with the print quality. Also, the experience with the first PETG sample showed me again how unpredictable 3D prints can actually be. Without proper quality control measures, our 3D prints shouldn't be used in safety critical applications. But what do you think? Was this something new for you, and how are you handling layer adhesion problems? Also, let me know what other print settings you'd like to see me test in the future. Leave a comment down below. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you have learned something new today. If you did, then leave a like and make sure that you're subscribed for upcoming videos. If you want to support my work, then head over to Patreon or help me out in other ways. You can also support the channel and get a free audiobook if you visit audible.com/cnckitchen or text cnckitchen to 500-500 and sign up for a 30-day free trial. By the way, also check out the other videos in my library. There are more you might like. Auf Wiedersehen and until next time.